Okay, this is a video entitled Math and Jesus. Jesus is the greatest mathematician ever, and the goal of this video is to prove that. Before entering into the esoteric, or more complicated, let us start by saying that algebra and geometry are two major divisions of mathematics. Algebra deals with sets of numbers, including the variable x. Now, some may object that x, well, that's a letter, it's not a number. But it is a number. The x in algebra is a definite but unspecified number. For example, there are two variables in this algebraic expression, x squared plus y squared equals 1. What is it saying? It refers to the set of all ordered pairs, x and y, such that the distance to the origin, 0, 0, is the constant 1. The Lord Jesus, who is Creator Christ, is the originator of calculus, infinitesimals, infinity, and every geometric shape. And we'll learn about that further on. But he also expects his fellow human beings to know how to measure, count, add, subtract, divide, multiply, and reason. For units of measure, he used the cubit, the measure, and the mile. He also used counting numbers. Now, I listed about 18 there, and the references are given. And also fractions. For example, he received a fraction from Zacchaeus and referred to another in the tithe. He multiplied, as did Zacchaeus. Remember 70 times 7? And he also subtracted 100 minus 1, 99 sheep left to go and get the one, and so on. And there are other examples. There's another example there. His disciple Luke used the term innumerable, suggestive of infinity. And the Lord also distinguished order, as in greater than, less than, few and many. Isaiah 40, speaking about the Messiah, the Lord, says that he sits upon the circle of the earth. It may well be that the word used could also be rendered sphere. Proverbs 8 says he inscribed a circle on the face of the deep. Circles and spheres are very important in geometry. In Acts 1, Jesus spoke of the remotest part. He didn't say parts, plural. He said remotest part, singular, of the earth. Now, if you live on a sphere, the remotest part is the other end of the diameter from where you stand, going through the earth's center and intersecting the opposite side of the globe. The Lord Jesus relates to infinity, for we read in John 3, "He whom God hath sent," referring to Christ, "speaks the words of God, for God gives not the Spirit by measure unto him." In other words, without measure. Jesus has received the Spirit without measure, infinitely. There is also in that verse a reference to the greatest three, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Jesus taught that the greatest three is the same as the greatest one. For he said, "To baptize in the name, singular, of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." Now, before continuing with more complicated matters, I need to address a criticism of the Bible for supposedly offering poor mathematics. 1 Kings 7 says, "Now he made the sea." This is talking about the article of furniture for the temple and all that. He made the sea, a laver, a place to wash, and so on, of cast metal, 10 cubits from brim to brim, circular in form. And there's a representation maybe of the kind of thing that we're talking about. And its height was 5 cubits and 30 cubits in circumference. It was a handbreadth thick, the text says. Now, since the ratio of circumference to diameter is pi, approximately 3.14, the claim is made that the Bible has made a mistake, showing God's revelation to be poor in math. But there are two main reasons why this is a foolish criticism. First, even 3.14 is an approximation. And of course, if you go with that text, you get the number 3. How many significant figures are required? We talk about significant figures in math. Since both diameter and circumference, 10 and 30, are given to be to the nearest integer, it is quite appropriate to give the ratio to the nearest integer. The integer 3 is correct, and 2 and 4 would not be correct. But the second reason is perhaps even more significant. The critic likely has not given attention to the thickness of the sea. If the brim to brim is the outside measure and the circumference is the inner measure, then the inside diameter, subtracting the two handbreadths, would be about 9.5 cubits. And the ratio of 30 to 9.5 is very close to pi, 3.15. And of course, if a handbreadth is different size and so on, you could even perhaps get it closer. When we say that the distance from Philadelphia, where I live, in New York is 100 miles, we know it is not as precise as saying 96.5 miles. The exact figure pi cannot be precisely expressed as a decimal fraction because the number is irrational. Even if you were to offer it to a million decimal places, it would still be inexact. What would be the point of the Bible giving the figure such as that, when even that is not exact? The Lord wanted to communicate and knows that whereas many humans do not like to be thought of as being illiterate, they do not mind so much being thought of as, or may even boast about being, innumerate, which is like the other word, illiterate and innumerate. Previously, we said that algebra is about sets of numbers. Now we affirm geometry, a second major heading under mathematics. It deals with sets of points, not sets of numbers, but sets of points. For example, there is a one-to-one correspondence between the set of points, that's geometry, on a circle, with center at the origin and having radius 1 unit, and the set of ordered pairs, now this is algebra, satisfying the equation x squared plus y squared equals 1. That is the equation for a circle, or a particular circle. This can be extended three-dimensionally. For example, x squared plus y squared plus z squared equals 1 is an equation with three variables. The geometric shape would be a sphere. And if we were to add the symbol less than to the equation, the set of all points would either be on the surface or inside the sphere. We would have a solid globe, think Earth, with diameter 2 and radius 1. Now, aren't we going a little far afield here? How does this relate to Jesus? The outer surface of the Earth approximates a sphere or a globe. And the Bible says that Jesus, and I'm quoting, in the beginning laid the foundation of the Earth. Jesus made the globe of the earth. Hebrews 8 speaks explicitly about Jesus, calls him, but of the Son, and quotes Psalm 102, part of it. And in verse 10, applies it to Jesus, those words to Jesus. But some people might say, well, I thought Psalm 102 is about Jehovah God, or Yahweh God. Yes, and Jesus is Jehovah God in human flesh. When a math teacher uses a compass to draw a circle on the chalk or whiteboard, one can be impressed, or even on a piece of paper. Which is more challenging, to draw a circle on a whiteboard or to make a spherical earth and hang it on nothing? upon nothing? Yes, Job 26 says, he stretches out the north over empty space and hangs the earth on nothing. He did the same for the sun, moons, comets, and stars. But some might object, the words quoted that you quoted from Hebrews as talked about Jesus, he laid the foundation of the earth, said nothing about sun, moons, comets, and stars. The verse continues, and the heavens are the work of your hands. Applying those words to Jesus Christ. In summary, the verse says that the entire universe was made by Jesus, and there are other verses in the Bible that affirm the same. Jesus is indeed the greatest mathematician ever. Now, a lot of people would say, well, maybe Sir Isaac Newton was the greatest mathematician. But what did Isaac Newton himself say? This is what he said, and I'm quoting from his Principia, which is really is a determinative work. And I'm quoting Isaac Newton. This most beautiful system of the sun, planets, and comets could only proceed from the counsel and dominion of an intelligent and powerful being. This being governs all, not as the soul of the world, but as Lord over all. And on account of his dominion, he is wont to be called Lord God, Pantocrator, or universal ruler. Okay, the universe is large. What about tiny little atoms and even subparticles like protons, electrons, neutrons? What about quarks and leptons? The Bible, referring to Jesus, affirms that in him, in Christ, all things hold together, Colossians 1:17. In other words, all atoms hold together in Jesus. Colossians was written by an apostle, but what did Jesus himself say? Well, in Matthew 10, Jesus said that the very hairs of your head are all numbered. How many mathematicians know the number of hairs on everyone's head all over the earth? Hairs are small. You can sort of see a little hair there in the fingers. And if Jesus had used quarks and leptons, how many people 2,000 years ago would have understood what he was talking about? The author of this presentation, or the voice that you hear, I taught math for 3 decades, and I'm particularly attracted to the number 3, and perhaps the Lord himself had a special place for that number, and maybe not only because of the Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but also in John 2, we read, Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and he was referring to his body, and in 3 days I will raise it up. There's that number 3. The Jews then said, it took 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days? In other words, even those who spoke out against Jesus remembered that number. One witness testified against Jesus saying, this man stated, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to rebuild it in 3 days. That's during the trial, or one of the trials. Later, when Jesus was actually on the cross, a mocker ordered, you who are going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. Now, this is not getting off track. The main track of this video is to encourage listeners like you to fall in love with man's only hope for heaven. He is also the greatest mathematician ever. Many deny the resurrection of Jesus, but here, even Jesus' enemies indirectly testify for him. These trials against Jesus really happened, and his enemies testified that he predicted his resurrection 3 days later, and that before he even died. False leaders do not predict their own resurrection 3 days after they die. Not even Houdini did that. There are also many other prophecies from the Old Testament pointing right to Jesus Christ. There's my book, 400 Prophecies, Appearances and Foreshadowings of Christ. You're welcome to get it. It's on Amazon and so on. But the main thing here is not to promote the sale of a book. It's to promote the Lord, who is the greatest mathematician and also the Messiah, both of Jews and Gentiles. And so that's the reason, the main track here. Now, maybe this next mathematical insight will touch your heart personally. In mathematics, there is a principle of substitution. And Christians affirm that Jesus is our substitute. Now, what is meant by that? Let's try to get a better understanding. Now, here's a quartic equation. It's an equation raised to the fourth power, set equal to zero. X to the fourth minus 9x squared plus 8 equals zero. Now, it has four solutions, and I give them there. But using the principle of substitution, and by letting J, and I chose J because Jesus starts with J, letting J equal X squared, you can rewrite that equation as a quadratic, not a quartic, but a quadratic. J squared minus 9J plus 8 equals zero. Something less challenging to solve. A lot of people know the quadratic formula and so on, and that becomes a quadratic. Now, the greatest mathematician ever to come to Earth as a problem solver and substituted himself in the place of the believer. Notice how he takes the filthy rags off and he gives him, the sinner, his perfect robe of righteousness. Now, in the second sentence of the beginning of this video, the word esoteric was mentioned. So I'm going to pick up on that. The trilobite eye was made by Creator Christ. And you say, trilobite? You know, that's a creature way back when. Evolutionist Ricardo Levi-Setti was professor of physics and director of the Enrico Fermi Institute at the University of Chicago and research associate at the Field Museum of Natural History. He put together a beautiful book, Trilobites, and it's published by the University of Chicago Press, containing these words, and I'm quoting here, because he's amazed. He's an evolutionary, but he's amazed at what he's about to reveal. And it touches on math. Among the remains of early life on Earth, the fossil record we find buried in ancient sedimentary rocks bears evidence of an extraordinary group of marine creatures, the trilobites. The position of these invertebrates in the, and I insert, supposed evolution of the animal kingdom is extraordinary because of their early ascent to a high level of functional complexity described in fascinating detail by their persistent and ubiquitous fossil remains. Now let's continue with what he's saying here. Because this one's, it's really, there are two men here listed, and he refers to them explicitly, Descartes and Huygens. The author continued, trilobites could see their immediate environment, and there's a picture of a trilobite with the eyes and so on, with amazingly sophisticated optical devices in the form of large composite eyes. The first use of optics coupled with sensory perception in nature. As a unique feat in the history of life, their eye lenses were shaped to correct for optical aberrations, with design identical to that proposed quite independently of any knowledge of trilobites by Descartes, René Descartes, and Christian Huygens. And he's continuing, and there's an enlargement of a trilobite eye. When we humans, now this is really an important slide, so please be attentive. When we humans construct optical elements, we sometimes cement together two lenses that have different refractive indices as a means of correcting particular lens defects. In fact, this optical doublet is a device so typically associated with human invention that its discovery in trilobites comes as something of a shock. But he gets more dramatic here. The realization that trilobites developed and used such devices over a billion years ago, and of course I don't believe the chronology there, makes the shock even greater. And a final discovery, that the refracting interface between the two lens elements in the trilobite's eye was designed in accordance with optical constructions worked out by Descartes and Huygens in the mid-17th century, borders on sheer science fiction. I guess who made those eyes? Creator Christ, the greatest mathematician ever. The book the author was having difficulty believing that trilobites could do this on their own, but naturalism demands no God. We got to go rule God out from the beginning. But he continued, by comparing the shape of the aspheric lens exit surfaces constructed by Huygens and Descartes with the two lens structures identified by Clarkson, little doubt remains that trilobites utilize the properties of Cartesian ovals more than 4 million years, again I disagree with that figure, before the 17th century masters discovered the principle. The design of the trilobite's eye lens could well qualify for a patent disclosure. There never was, nor will ever be, a greater mathematician than the Lord Jesus Christ, who also died on the cross for me and for many others. And he came alive again 3 days later, as he promised. Now, we could continue with the truth that mathematics is the basic language of creation, illustrating this with examples in nature of the Fibonacci sequence there to the right, for example. There is much mathematics in music and symmetry, but let us conclude with the orderliness of triangles. We have referred to three in relationship to the Trinity and the 3 days of prophecy of the resurrection, but triangles are also marvelous in relation to threeness. Triangles have three vertices and three sides. When three lines in a play come together, and a plane come together at a single point, we say that the lines are concurrent. Three points can be collinear, but three lines can be concurrent at a specific point. It is typical that two lines in a plane will intersect, otherwise they would be parallel. But that a third should go through that exact same point is very special. Now let's take a look at these two triangles here. First, the one on the left. Every triangle in the universe has three perpendicular bisectors. You can see them in red there in the diagram on the left. Those three perpendicular bisectors always come together. They're always concurrent at a single point. We give the name of that point of centricity circumcenter, as it is equidistant from the three vertices. In other words, you can circumscribe a circle about that point that touches all three vertices. Now let's skip to the next triangle. Every triangle in the universe also has three medians, or in other words, segments from the vertex to the midpoint of the opposite side. They too are always concurrent, come together at a single point. That point is called the centroid, and it is the only point that is a third the distance from each side to the opposite vertex. This is true for all three medians of any triangle in the universe. I've got two more triangles here to talk about. Every triangle in the universe has three angle bisectors, which are always concurrent at a single point, called the incenter. Whereas the circumcenter is always equidistant to the three vertices, this incenter is always equidistant from the three sides. You can inscribe a circle tangent to the three sides using that incenter. And finally, every triangle in the universe has three altitudes. And they also are concurrent at a single point, which is called the orthocenter. All of this points to a remarkable orderliness in the universe. Triangles have a unity, but also a threeness. Infinitely more special is God triune, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. What a mighty Christ we serve! What a mighty Creator! Let us bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty Christ we serve.